Thank you, Danielle. Good morning, everybody. Hey, I am glad to be with you this morning. Appreciate your prayers for me last Sunday as I was under the weather and unable to be here. Believe me, you wouldn't want me here last Sunday. I tried to be here and couldn't. But let me tell you this morning, there is no place that I'd rather be this morning than studying this section of Scripture with you this morning, and I mean that sincerely. Would you please go ahead and open up your Bibles to John's Gospel, chapter 18, 27 this morning. And the portion of Scripture that we're devoting our time today is Christ's arrest in the Garden of Eden, Garden of Gethsemane. And when he's being arrested and the events that follow after that is Peter's denial of him. The topic, in fact, that we're going to be talking about today is a tough one. It's one that probably wouldn't be on the top five list of most preachers to preach about. But it's one that's needed, I believe, now more than ever. And it's the topic of backsliding. What a word. That's a word we just don't hear too much about anymore. What does it even mean? Well, let me give you the definition of backsliding. Backsliding simply means to move away in regards to my relationship with God. That I once was close with God, but to backslide means that now there's a gap. Now there's a distance between me and God. Some other words that are associated with is the backslider. A backslider is the person who is backsliding. And backslidden is the condition of the backslider. Clear as mud? All right. Well, let me illustrate it maybe this way for you this morning. As I was preparing the sermon now 2 weeks ago, I was trying to think of an illustration that would really hit home that we could relate to in regards to our journey of following Jesus. And truth be known, all of us from time to time will backslide. It is a roller coaster ride to follow Jesus. Some seasons of life, man, we are close, we're on the peak, we're on the pinnacle. Man, it's on fire, it's rocking. Other seasons, we are in the valley, and we're left asking similar questions to Jesus, like he asked on the cross, my God, why have you forsaken me? Where are you? I can't see you. Well, as I was thinking through that, this video, and I searched for it, and I edited it a little bit. Let me just preface it. I don't know these people in this video, okay? But I think we can all relate. Let's kill the lights and let's watch this video and see if you can relate to backsliding a little bit this morning. Can you relate? Have you ever felt that way in regards to your relationship with Jesus? That you have a desire, you have a want to, you just don't have the capacity to do it. And that's a great illustration, I believe, of backsliding. It's not gaining any forward momentum. It's slipping and sliding and losing traction, being so frustrated with your relationship with Jesus that you just give up. I don't even know if this thing's working. By the way, how many of you recognize the song that was played there? Welcome to my generation, Generation Z, right? New kids on the block. Woo! Anyway, what I'm trying to say about backsliding is this, that when it comes to your relationship with Jesus, we all should be growing. We should all be having forward momentum. But the truth is, a lot of us don't. And while it's okay to have a season of backsliding, if you remain in this state for too long, pretty soon you're going to be falling away from Him. And we want to prevent that as much as possible. And today we're going to learn about backsliding from the events of Simon Peter. And I want you to think back over Simon Peter's life as he's been following Jesus and what we've learned about Simon Peter. He is definitely the outspoken one, the leader of the disciples. Would you agree with that? Think about the things he's done. Think about the things he said. How does then someone who was so fervent in their faith and so on fire in their relationship with Jesus get to the point where you claim you don't even know him? How does that happen? Because here's the thing about backsliding, as you're slipping and sliding. It is a gradual thing. It's not intentional. Nobody sets out and be like, today I'm going to fall away from Jesus. It's totally gradual and it happens over time. And what we're going to see is that while John chapter 8 records the denial of Simon Peter to Jesus, there's something that's been happening in Simon's life for a while. So if you find yourself this morning in regards to your relationship with Jesus, not where you want it to be, I want you to take serious evaluation and figure out what is it that's changed. What is it that's happened in your life? Why is it that you don't feel as close to Jesus or connected to Jesus as you once did? If you're a note taker, this is where we need to start. Make a note of this. Jesus hasn't changed. Why is it that that is where we should begin when we talk about backsliding? Why is it important to note that Jesus hasn't changed? Here's why. Because if there's a gap, if you're feeling distant from Jesus, let me assure you, He hasn't moved. He hasn't distanced Himself from you. And so if you're feeling distant from Jesus, who's changed? Everybody point to the universal person of who it is that's changed if I feel distant from God. It's me, right? Now, this is important to make note of too, that when we backslide, we're not backsliding from a place. We're backsliding from a person. While it's true that backslidden people are sometimes wavering in their church attendance, it's important to know that they're not backsliding from the church, they're backsliding from Jesus. We don't backslide from reading the Bible, we backslide from the author of the Bible. We don't back away from serving, we back away from the one we've been called to serve. And so you need to understand that when we talk about backsliding, it's not positional, it's not like, well, they're not among us anymore, it's that it's about relationship. They've moved away from Jesus Christ. And in our text this morning, we get a clear understanding that Jesus has not changed. He's remained constant from the time that He started His ministry. Let's start here in verses 1 through 4 of John 18. When Jesus had spoken these words, He went away with His disciples across the ravine of the Kidron, where there was a garden which He entered with His disciples. Now Judas, who was betraying Him, also knew the place, because Jesus had often met there with His disciples. So Judas has been gone since John chapter 13. Remember that? They were in the upper room. Jesus is washing the disciples' feet. He institutes the Lord's Supper, and He identifies the one who will betray Him, and He says, the one who's going to betray me is the one I'm dipping bread with. And he recognizes Judas as his betrayer, and then he tells Judas, hey, whatever you intend to do, do it quickly. In other words, I know what you're going to do. Get on with it. And so Judas has been gone since John chapter 13. But now, in John chapter 18, here comes Judas, and he's not alone. Notice verse 3. So Judas, having obtained the Roman cohort and officers from the chief priests and the Pharisees, came there with lanterns, torches, and weapons. How interesting is this? Judas brings with him a portion of the Roman army. The religious leaders, made up of chief priests and Pharisees. And notice what they're carrying. Lanterns, torches, and weapons. The lanterns and torches are there to identify the person they're going to arrest, and the weapons are there to ensure that they do it with very little resistance. Let's talk about this cohort just for a second. Did you know that a cohort was usually made up of 600 soldiers? And what's furthermore interesting is that Judas must have had the permission of Pilate to obtain these Roman soldiers. Pilate, the governor, must have been okay with Judas using these soldiers. Because in Matthew chapter 27, we know that Pilate clearly had knowledge about what it was that was happening with Jesus. But 600 soldiers, really? That seems like overkill to me, doesn't it? Not really. It makes sense when you stop to think about it. Rome did not want any civil unrest. And they were very much aware of the popularity of Jesus Christ. Think about the thousands of people who throughout Jesus' ministry came to him to listen to him teach, who came to be fed by him, be healed by him. They knew that he was vastly popular. And so it's not surprising that they brought 600 armed men because they didn't know who was going to be with him. So imagine Judas, if you will, just walking out in front of this group, and the arrogance with which he was walking. And then the audacity to approach Jesus and kiss him. While John's gospel does not record that, the other gospels do. Verse 4. Therefore, Jesus, knowing all the things that were coming upon him, came out into the open and said to them, "Whom are you seeking?" Make a note of this. Jesus never changes. Even now, he still has full knowledge. He's had full knowledge. And even now, in these moments, Jesus still knows all the things that are happening, that were coming upon him. Did Jesus know that he would be tortured and crucified and take upon him the sins of the world? Yes, he knew. And knowing what was coming, I love Jesus' leadership. He steps out into the open. And he says, who are you looking for? Man, aren't you glad? Aren't you glad that God protects you from what's coming around the corner? Aren't you glad that you don't know the burdens that tomorrow will bring? And that's intentional on God's part. Because Jesus can handle it. You and I can't. The mercy of God to shield me from what's coming around the corner. And wasn't it Jesus himself who said, worry about today because tomorrow has enough trouble of its own, right? Every day's got enough trouble. Imagine the weight on Jesus' shoulders knowing what was coming next. That's omniscience. And he knows everything. He never changes. And he still hasn't changed. And then make a note of this, Jesus still has awesome power. When I was studying these verses, it hit me for the first time, verses 5 and 6. Follow along. They answered him, "We're looking for Jesus the Nazarene." And he said to them, "I am he." And Judas also, who was betraying him, was standing with them. Verse 6 is awesome. Now then, when he said to them, "I am he," they drew back and they fell to the ground. Couple things here I want to point out to you. I've underlined the phrase that Jesus uses as he's answering his disciples, answering these men, "Who are you? We're looking for Jesus of Nazareth." Did you notice his response? He says, "I am he." Now, if you have a New American Standard Bible, I want you to look at the word "he." Is it in italics? It should be. If you have the NIV, there's no italics there. There's no mention of it, no really recognition of it. But that's why I like the New American Standard Bible. Did you know in the original language, whenever the English translation is there and there is a word in italics, that word is not in the original Greek. It is supplied in the English. Did you know that? And I think it's really important the response that Jesus gives. I think it would have been better left translated, I am. Because we've studied about the significance of that name that Jesus uses. It's the name of deity. It's the name of God. And as his accusers are coming to him, he's reminding everybody who's on scene, I am God. And notice what happens to the soldiers and those who are seeking to arrest him. It's a moment. They fall to the ground at the name of Jesus. That's not the first time the Bible records that happening. You remember in Acts, as Saul of Tarsus was on his way to Damascus, we later know him as Paul, and he encounters Jesus the Christ. Do you remember what happened to Paul? He was knocked to his knees and he was left blind. That's awesome power. And even in this moment where it looks like all hope is lost, Jesus is declaring, I'm still in control. And what's even more amazing is that while he is still in control of the situation, Jesus still has total surrender. Let's look at verses 7 through 14. He then asked them again, whom are you seeking? And they said, Jesus the Nazarene. Jesus answered, I told you, I am he. So if you're seeking me, let these men go on their way. This took place so that the word which the Lord spoke would be fulfilled. Of those whom you have given me, I lost not one. And so while Jesus does have absolute power, he is in complete submission to the Father's will. What a shepherd. He steps out in front to protect his disciples. I'm the one you want. Let these guys go. Verse 10. Simon Peter, since he had a sword, drew it, and he struck the high priest's slave and cut off his right ear. And the slave's name was Malchus. Now, I have to ask, what on earth is a fisherman doing with a sword? This is crazy. Like, how bad are you at killing that you cut off the guy's ear? First of all, look at the odds. There are 600 soldiers against 12, including Jesus. How good should the first shot be? I mean, it's going to get really messy after this, so your first move better be a good play. And so Peter cuts off the guy's ear. Just something else that I found interesting, being left-handed, it would appear as though from this detail in the text that perhaps Simon Peter might have been left-handed because he cut off Malchus's right ear, and you usually would draw your sword across the body, holding it in his left hand to strike at him and cutting off his right ear. Isn't that amazing? Little detail I like. Anyway, back to verse 11. Oh, by the way, we don't know whatever became or happened to Malchus. It's the only time he's mentioned in Scripture. But I would like to think, maybe, just maybe, Malchus got saved. I mean, I think it'd be pretty difficult to be the recipient of a miracle like this, because after his ear is severed, the other gospel writers tell us that he picks it up and he restores, I mean, dusts it off, blows it off, puts it on his ear. I love the miracle. And he tells us that Jesus healed this man. And I would think that it'd be difficult to be the recipient of a miracle like that and not believe that Jesus is God. So maybe we'll see Malchus in heaven one day. Verse 11, so Jesus said to Peter, put the sword into the sheath and listen to the submission of Jesus. The cup which the Father has given me, am I not to drink it? So the Roman cohort, the commander, the officers of the Jews arrested Jesus and bound him, and they brought him to Annas first. For he was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was the high priest that year. Now Caiaphas was the one who had advised the Jews that it was in their best interest for one man to die in behalf of all the people. And so in these verses, Jesus submits himself to the cup of wrath that was to be poured out by God. You understand that, don't you? That the cup that Jesus was drinking, yes, it was suffering, but more importantly, it was God's wrath. That Jesus drank of the cup of wrath so you wouldn't have to. That he took on God's wrath of himself that would so you and I would be spared of that. All of that to say this. Does Peter even realize who it is he's about to deny? Not once, not twice, three times. He's backsliding away from a Jesus who never has changed. He's remained constant. He remains the same. Hebrews tells us he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And so even today, Jesus has full knowledge. He has awesome power. He has complete surrender to the will of the Father. And if you're feeling distant from Jesus, if you're feeling like something has changed in regards to your relationship with him, you have to understand he hasn't changed. He hasn't shifted. It's you that's moved from him. And if you have moved from him, be encouraged by the person of Jesus Christ today. Well, that's the first thing. Jesus doesn't change. And now throughout the rest of our text this morning, we're going to move on to the evidences of backsliding. As I already said, backsliding is a process. It doesn't happen in an instant. And while what we're getting ready to study this morning seems to take place in an instant, it's really just evidence that something has been brewing underneath the surface for a while. And so here's four evidences that Peter has been in a downward spiral, backsliding away from Jesus for quite some time. And the first is this, a reliance on self. Look at the text. Who is the opposition that Peter is facing in this moment? It's the chief priests, it's the Pharisees, it's Judas, it's 600 soldiers. And what's Peter's solution to the opposition? I'll fix it. And this was a long pattern repeating itself in Peter's life, even for the 3 years he was following Jesus. I mean, think up to the moments leading up to the arrest. The other Gospels record it. John doesn't record it. But as Jesus is in the Garden of Gethsemane, you remember Jesus invites Peter, James, and John to join him in prayer. And while Jesus is fervently praying for hours on end, what's Simon doing? He's sleeping. So Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane finally comes to a point of submission. Not my will, but your will be done. I'm okay, Father, with whatever you want done. He gets to a place of submission. Why isn't Peter at a place of submission? He's got his sword on, like, no! Why isn't he come to this place? Because he's been sleeping. He hasn't been practicing the disciplines that Jesus has been practicing. Earlier on in the text, we see that all throughout Simon's life, there are other examples that he was all about his agenda, what he wanted. Several times throughout John's gospel alone, we are recorded the words where Peter says, "No, Lord." Let me just give you a couple of examples. Starting back, let me take you first to Matthew's gospel. In Matthew chapter 16, you remember Jesus was declaring to his disciples for the first time that he was going to die? And do you remember what Peter said to Jesus? "No, Lord." And Jesus would respond with what? "Get behind me, Satan." And then as we come to John chapter 13, and twice Peter says, "No, Lord," which is kind of an oxymoron in and of itself. Because if you're calling Jesus Lord, it means you surrender to him. And if you're saying, "No, Lord," that's a contradiction of terms. And in John chapter 13, as Jesus is washing the disciples' feet, he comes to Peter and says, "I'm going to wash you." And what's Peter say? "No, Lord, never shall you wash my feet." And then Jesus is like, "Look," later on in John chapter 13, he's like, "Look, Peter, you're going to deny me three times." And what's he say then? "No, Lord, even if I have to die for you, I will do it. I will remain faithful." Peter's greatest weakness was his perceived strength. Pride goes before the fall. He was a man who was filled and consumed with pride. But before we get too hard on Peter, let's take a good hard look at ourselves, because that's how you know you're backsliding. You're smart, you know. Think of some of the opposition that you've been facing in your life. What is it that you're leaning on? Your own understanding, your own power, your financial resources, your own strength? Or are you relying and waiting on the Lord? Recovery from backsliding comes not when we think that we're strong, but when we admit that we're weak. And this had been something that's been going on in his life, a reliance on self. I'll fix it. I'll take care of it. Well, verse 15 shows us the second piece of evidence that might be an indicator that you might be backsliding. Here it is, a reluctance to stand strong. A reluctance to stand strong. Verses 15 through 17, Simon Peter was following Jesus, and so was another disciple. By the way, the unnamed disciple is the author of John's Gospel, the Apostle John. Now that disciple was known to the high priest, and he entered with Jesus into the courtyard of the high priest, but Peter was standing at the door outside, and so the other disciple, who was known to the high priest, went out, spoke to the doorkeeper, and brought Peter in. Then the slave woman who was at the doorkeeper said to Peter, "You are not also one of this man's disciples, are you?" And Peter replied, "I am not." That's a very pointed question, seeking a very pointed response. It's seeking a negative answer. You're not one of his disciples too, are you? What's the answer that's being prompted for? No. You see, Peter remained at a distance. He was already fearful. That's why he reacted the way that he did when he was in the garden with a sword. And this girl makes an obvious connection. He's a disciple. And Peter had a reluctance to stand strong when in the wrong company. I used to think that peer pressure was something that was experienced only by those who were in high school. But after I graduated high school, to my surprise, peer pressure didn't disappear. And even as an adult, especially in small communities, there is heavy peer pressure that exists to keep up with the Joneses, to have your kids in the same sports that everybody else has their kids in, to let your kids do what other parents are letting their kids do. All sorts of pressure. And there's pressure to bend and to compromise your values and your beliefs that Jesus wants you to have concerning Him. Think about where you work. Have you ever had to compromise your values for your boss, for your coworkers? Were you pressured to give in? Here's the principle. When surrounded by wrongdoers, wrongdoing comes easily. You ever been caught up in the wrong crowd at the wrong time, and it just kind of got caught up in things, and you couldn't even explain why you did what you did. It just seemed that everybody else around you was doing it, and there was a failure, a reluctance to stand strong when in the wrong company. And maybe you're like, look, I've got people in my life who need to know Jesus, and I'm the only influence that they have. Listen, you are not to a place where you are strong enough to pull those unbelievers out of the pit that they're in. In fact, what's happening there is while you're trying to influence them and pull them out of the pit, they're influencing you and pulling you down into the pit. And so you need to check your friends. And maybe for right now, temporarily speaking, you need to sever some ties, cut some strings with the friends and influencers in your life. And that's not just talking to high school kids. That's talking to adults. Question, are your closest friends, friends of faith? Not just churchgoers, Jesus followers. Do your closest friends have this focus? I don't know what's coming down the road. I don't know what's going to be around the corner, but we're going to stick together and we're going to stick to God. Is that the mentality of your friends? Let me tell you something. 22 years in a church, some of my closest friends have been other ministers in this area who we've just kind of kept each other accountable, who we've allowed to vent to one another once in a while when life is tough, but we've also encouraged one another. And had it not been for those friends in my life, I can guarantee you, I wouldn't still be here at Burnside Christian Church. But I want to encourage you to get some friends like that in your life. And you'll see that backsliding won't be the battle that it has been. Evidences of backsliding, a reliance on self, a reluctance to stand strong, and these next two will come quickly because they're similar. Thirdly, a refusal to identify with Christ. Verse 25, now Simon Peter was still standing and warming himself near the fire, so they said to him, "You're not one of his disciples as well, are you?" And he denied it and said, "No, I'm not a Christ follower." Has that ever happened to you? The topic of religion comes up, or they make fun of Christians for some belief, and you just want to blend in. You just want to kind of fit in and be like everybody else, and you just kind of want to ignore the fact that you're a Christ follower. Peter wanted one foot in each camp, and I feel like a lot of us are the same way. We want to compartmentalize our relationship with Jesus. I'll come to church, Lord. I'll be here every Sunday, but you get one day. And when I'm at work, when I'm at school, I'm going to live for me. I'm going to be the way that I need to be. But when I come here, Lord, I'm all yours. I'm all in. And that's kind of what I see happening here with Peter. It's a refusal to identify wholeheartedly with Jesus. When he's with Jesus, he's following Jesus. When he's with the crowd, he's like the crowd. And that's how we can sense that Peter is backsliding. You remember what's going to happen, don't you, with Peter that we're going to study in just a few weeks. After this denial of Jesus, where does Peter find himself? Jesus isn't here. I guess I'm going to go back and become a fisherman. It's a refusal to identify with Jesus. And then finally, another evidence of backsliding is a rejection of the truth. Verse 26 and 27, one of the slaves of the high priest who was related to the one whose ear Peter cut off. Wow, what are the chances of that? Running into the relative of the guy that you just tried to kill. And so Peter runs into one of the relatives of Malchus, and this relative probably wasn't in a good mood. And this relative confronts Peter. "Did I not see you in the garden with him?" With Jesus? Verse 27, Peter denied it again, and immediately a rooster crowed. I think it's so fitting that it's a rooster. You realize it could have been a myriad of other signs that could have been there, but why do you suppose it was a rooster? That's a wake-up call, isn't it? Roosters give a wake-up call, and I think it's no coincidence that this rooster crows, and then Peter comes to his senses and realizes how far away I am from Jesus, whom I love. And I'm praying for a wake-up call for you. I'm praying for a wake-up call for me. Matthew's gospel gives the detail that as soon as Peter heard the rooster crow, that he went out and he wept bitterly. Repentant, truly sorry, wanting to change. That's where he was at. And so as we wrap up our time together in God's Word, I want to ask you to think about your life. If you're taking notes, you'll notice at the bottom of your listening sheet, there's two rows of numbers, 0 through 10. On the top row of those two rows, I want you to circle what your spiritual life was like 5 years ago. Shoot, last year. On a scale of 0 to 10, 10 being in fuego, on fire, best day ever, with Jesus, in my Bible, praying, in church, filled with joy, empowered by the Holy Spirit, walking with the Lord. That's what 10 is. How would you describe your spiritual life 5 years ago, 1 year ago, whatever you were at last year? And then below that, I want you to take time, get alone, don't do it today. It needs to be between you and the Lord. Let the Holy Spirit speak to you. And I want you to evaluate honestly and assess honestly where you are at today in regards to your relationship with Jesus. 10 being really close, 0 feeling distant. How would you rank your relationship with Him? And if you notice a difference, a sliding, a smaller a backsliding, if you sense that there is that in your life, well, what is it that you can do? Really quickly, three things to do. If those numbers, if the top number is higher than your bottom number, three things to do. Recognize your condition. Have that wake-up call. Listen to the rooster. Weep bitterly. Recognize your position, your condition. Repent of your position. Come, let us return to the Lord. Right? That's a good statement. Repent of your position. And then finally, return to the Lord. Those are the three steps needed to return back, to prevent the backsliding. And maybe this morning you're looking at that list and you're like, man, I'm pretty good. I'm better than I was just a year ago, 3 years ago. Great, awesome. But please be wary. Please be on the alert. Stand firm in your faith, because I believe difficult days are ahead. And this is why it's a call back to repentance. This is why it's a call back to getting your relationship right with the Lord now. I believe tough days are ahead for Christians, where I've already experienced some tough days. But the kingdom of God, the kingdom of light, is under attack by the kingdom of darkness. And if you're not in a good position, if you're not near Jesus when the storm erupts, it's only going to get worse. And so we're going to stand together. We're going to have a time of decision this morning. But first, I'm going to pray. Let's pray. Will you stand with me? Father God, we do thank you for this day, and we thank you, Father, for your word that we get to study it together. God, thank you for being patient with us, for loving us, for never changing. God, I pray this morning that for those who need it, that this would be the wake-up call. That we would hear your voice very clearly speaking to us. Thank you for wanting us back. And not being bitter about it, not wanting to cut ties, God, but you sincerely desire for us to draw closer to you, even when we're hurting, even when our life is a mess. And I pray this morning, Father, that this would be the day where we would wake up from our slumber and press hard into you. God, I pray for our church. I pray that we would be a healthy church, a loving church, a church that outreaches and cares about the lost, and that we would not grow weary in serving you. I pray for our country. And I pray, Father, that you would give us the wisdom to make choices to draw back to you. And I pray, Father, this morning, especially for Ukraine, that there might be peace experienced, that you might change Putin's heart and his mind. Father, thank you again for all that you've given to us and granted to us, especially the favor that we have in Jesus Christ. We pray these things in your Son's name. Amen.